My name is Matt Dennis. I work at DataStax. I've been there for about 2.5 years. Help a lot of our customers with their architecture and design, occasionally doing training. I used to write a lot of code in Cassandra. Now I write mostly code around Cassandra. Today's talk is mostly about data modeling and the interactions that you do with the data model to achieve the goals that you want, focusing kind of on durability. So as a brief overview of the Cassandra data model, there are key spaces, column families, rows, columns, more properly called tuples, if you ask me, which consist of names, values, timestamps, and TTLs. So key spaces contain column families. Column families contain multiple rows, and rows contain multiple columns, which are each a name, a value, a timestamp, and a tuple. But given that this is supposed to be a technical deep dive, and most of you have already been dealing with Cassandra at some point for a while, we're basically going to skip over all of that and go right into the details. So I'm going to do a banking application. Got some questions for the audience, but I kind of need to establish a baseline first. So how many of you are willing to raise your hand? Awesome. OK, that's great. How many of you think you can't build a proper banking application on Cassandra? A few. OK. Not bad. So we're going to go with just a few methods on here. We're going to be able to credit an account or debit an account. We're going to be able to read the account balance. And then the interesting one, the one that most people actually care about that makes it hard in a distributed system, is we're going to transfer funds. Everyone always says work backwards from your queries. The only query that we really have is get account balance. We want to be able to, for a given account, tell me what the balance in that account is. And so we have a column family for that, which looks like this. The value on the left, all balls are 0000, is, if you think of it as kind of the start of time, it's the special value. It's going to contain the current base total, which is, you know, everything up until some point of time that represents the balance for that account. All balls comes from Postgres. When you set the zero timestamp, it zeros all across, looks like balls. So the transaction ID is some ID that is unique to the transaction you're generating. A check number, a ID from a terminal processor, an ATM machine, your web session ID plus your order number, whatever it is that makes that absolutely unique and idempotent. What I mean by that is if I replay the same transaction, I need to get the same ID on it. This is kind of key to being able to effectively determine what has happened so that you can distinguish between I accidentally submitted the same transaction twice or I submitted two different transactions that happen to look very similar to one another. The details, which would be the column value for that column, is everything that makes up that change, everything that you need to make it unique and all the details about it, the amount of money that's being debited or credited and which account it came from and which account it went to. So getting the account balance in that model is actually pretty easy. You read the entire row and you apply the deltas to the base. So in this case, if I had a balance of $123.45 at one point, and I deposited $10 and I spent, you know, $20, then if I took the 123 and added 10 and subtracted 20, then I would end up with $113.45. So at any point in time, I can always read this row and calculate what my balance is. It's efficient to do that because I only need to read one row. I'm not having a bunch of secondary indexes or other seeks on disk that are going to require me to go get a bunch of small deltas from everywhere. I can get it all out of one row. Crediting the account is pretty straightforward as well. I write the details to that column family. Whenever I want to add $10 to an account or charge $10 to an account, then all I have to do is make another column. And because all the details for that transaction are represented in a column on its own, there's no chance of that being halfway updated. I can write it in there and I can say, here's this new transaction, I've spent $10. And either all the details about that transaction go in because they're all in one column, or they don't. There's no split reads between that or no dirty reads. Obviously, the problem with this is that each account that you have, if you keep doing that for a long time, you're going to have some base value and a whole bunch of deltas on it. So every time you read the account balance, you're doing more and more work, more and more math to consolidate those values together. we need to be able to safely recalculate the base to avoid unbounded growth. And that's where the hard part of this actually comes in. So being able to do that requires some way of being able to calculate the new base without any kind of race conditions. A single master setup actually works pretty well for this because it's not broken when the master is down. The system still operates correctly. I'm just not consolidating my values. It's not that the system is unavailable. It's not that the system is giving me incorrect results. Things are just slowing down some. So otherwise, you know, a single point of failure like a master would be a very bad design. You don't want one machine that everything depends on. So just to be clear, that's not what I'm recommending here. That's not what's happening. It's a machine that's kind of a performance optimization. The correctness of the system would work without the master at all. You would just have these deltas that pile up forever and ever, and then eventually it would be too slow to be useful. So in kind of the wall of text form here, the easiest way to do that is assign accounts to consolidators or processors, some number of nodes. You can have as many as you'd like that you need for your availability and your scale. The key point is that because it's the master, it's the only one that can actually consolidate that data. So you know that when it does a read and it does a write of it later, that it's always seeing its own view because it's never modifying, that no one else is ever modifying the data. Anyone else can read it whenever they would like. But the general process is I read the account row, I calculate the new base, and all at once I write the new base value and I delete my deltas. The row level isolation in Cassandra guarantees that you either see the old base and the deltas, or you see the new base and no deltas. You can't ever see anything in between. Prior to the row level isolation in Cassandra, this algorithm doesn't work because I could write a new base and somebody could slip in a read right between that, read the newly calculated base, and also read the deltas that were going to be deleted but have not yet been deleted, and you would overcount the balance. Or the reverse could happen, and you could undercount the balance. With row-level isolation, that's no longer possible. For any given read, you'll always see the old pre-change values or the new values, nothing in between. On a failure, so the processor that's doing this needs to write it at quorum, because it has to be able to guarantee that when it calculates a new base and it writes that into Cassandra and it reads it back later, it needs to know that it's seeing the most recently written value that it's put in there. If it was ever to get an old value, then you would calculate the wrong results. You would write 10 in there, for example. Let's say 10 is already in there, and I read a delta of 5. I calculate the new value is 15, and I write the base is 15, and I delete the delta of 5. And then immediately after that, I do another read, and I don't see that change. I see the 10, and I see some other deltas, and I apply them and I write a new base, I've now lost that original delta because I've overwritten a value because I didn't see it. Writing at a consistency level of quorum and reading at a consistency level of quorum prevents that. That also means that you can tolerate node failures. If you have a replication factor of 3, I can tolerate one arbitrary failure, a network partition, a data center going down if I'm running across 3 data centers, a disk failure, a hardware failure, restarting it, upgrading, anything I'm doing for maintenance. If that's not good enough, if one failure is not okay, you can have a replication factor of 5, and I can tolerate 2 arbitrary failures. And you can take that up as far as you would like. Running across multiple data centers and using a full quorum often introduces a lot of high latency. In this case, that's not a problem because nobody is waiting on this consolidator. Remember, this is happening asynchronously in the background. My transaction at this point has already been written, has already been completed, and this is just me shortening the values. It's an optimization. So the fact that I have to wait for round trips to other data centers and back is not really an issue. There's some caveats about when you do have a failure at quorum. For example, you have a replication factor of 3 and 2 nodes fail while you're trying to do this right, then you need to be able to recover from that, and there's some slides in the future to talk about that. If you're familiar with databases or transactional systems in general, this is essentially checkpointing, is that I have all these deltas that I'm applying to the system, and periodically I roll them up and say, this is the state of the system at this point in time, and that's when I write the base, that would be a checkpoint in like a transaction log, and then I keep applying future deltas. So in a more visual form, the way this looks is I have some row for account X, and if you think of X, Y, and Z as different members of a set, then what I want to guarantee is that when I look at the final set, if I union all my sets together, I always see the appropriate value, the correct value. I never see X twice, I never see Y twice, I never miss a Z. So if this is the starting point that I have, whenever the processor, the consolidator writes at consistency level quorum, then I'm guaranteed that if I do a read at quorum, I will see that value, I won't see some other value. I will never issue two reads from the same consolidator for the same account at the same time, and I can guarantee that because I'm on one machine. So what I'll do is I'll read my base value is X, and then these two deltas, Y and Z. I'll calculate that the new base is now the set of X and Y and Z, and I will issue deletes for those two deltas, which turn into tombstones in Cassandra. And again, because of row-level isolation, I'm guaranteed that I either see X, Y, Z as separate sets, or I see X, Y, Z all as one set, and I don't see them in the other columns. You only get one or the other. So the writes that I do can be at any consistency level that meet your durability and availability and consistency requirements. That probably means quorum, because if I do a write on a transaction and I read it later, I want to see that value. I don't want to do a write and say you charge $10 and then turn around immediately later and not see that charge. The way you can guarantee that is write a quorum, but if you were less concerned about this, for example, if you're at Starbucks, they don't even check your balance at, you know, $5 transaction. They just want you out the door. And so the authorization comes back immediately. So you could just write it to two machines locally in a data center, knowing that you wouldn't lose the data, even though someone else could be reading it and may see a different value. The updates to the queries, though, what the consolidation does, though, is, like I said, it has to be at quorum, and the initial read needs to be at all or after a failure. So why do you have to have that read at all? If you think of the top as being the left set is the base value, and the right set are all the deltas that I have, then I could do a write concurrently from another node, and it could show up on node 0 before it showed up on node 1 and node 2. That can also happen if you do a write at quorum and it fails. So when I read, I could potentially read from node 1 and node 2, which returns empty sets. At the same time that that's happening, I could read from node 0 and node 1, in which case I would see X, and I would calculate the new base as X, and then I would do a write for X. While that's going on, someone wrote to a different node, and that value ended up on node 2, but is not yet propagated to node 0 and node 1. That's the fourth row down, where it says concurrent write for Y. At that point, I can do a quorum read from node 1 and node 2, and I can see Y, but I won't see X. And so when I write that back, I've actually propagated propagated Y over to the base set, but I've lost X. X is now gone entirely. So the problem came from me doing a failed write on row 3. I calculated what the value of X should have been because I saw X, and so I said, the new base is X, but there is no delta, I'm deleting that. And so I'll either see X in the new set or the old set. I won't see it in both, but if that write fails, you don't actually know what happened. It's very possible that it got on one node, but not on any of the others. And so the same time that that's happening, if someone writes into Y, and either it's being done concurrently or it failed, then I now have the state that says concurrent write for Y, and because I'm reading at quorum, I read and I only see node 1 and node 2, so I don't see the value for X, and so I overwrite it with a new base. But I'm not overwriting X anywhere out of the delta list, the delete for that, and so that will propagate on its own. The way you solve that is if I had failed on row 3 here, if I don't process anything else until I'm able to do a read at concurrency level all, then I would have seen Y down on the fourth row. When I did a read for that, I would have seen why. I would have correctly calculated that the result needs to be the base, which is currently x, plus y, and then I would delete y. And so my end result would be x and y in the base set. If you've only got one hardware failure, quorum works fine for this. You don't have to deal with consistency level all. But when you do have a failure, when you're doing a write, or whenever you're first starting the node, the very first time you see an account on that node, you need to be able to guarantee that you see the correct state of the system. Which means if you boot the consolidator when you've got a node down, the consolidations don't start happening until you bring that Cassandra node back up. But as I said, that doesn't really matter because the correctness of the system is not dependent on the consolidator. It's fine if it's down for a while. So clearly, the source account and the destination account can be on different nodes. And if I'm trying to transfer data from one account to the other, that's where the problem comes in. Because if they're in the same node, if they're on the same row, or they're going to the same machine, then I could write code that on that machine, you know, basically is synchronized or has some sort of mutual exclusion where I can deduct the money from X and add it to Y and then call that complete. You can't do that if they're on different machines. So how do you maintain the consistency across them when you're doing data transfers? Well, the common approach is to use a transaction log. And if you don't know what that is, you know, Wikipedia is awesome. But Oracle has one, Postgres has one, MySQL, SQL Server. Just about everything that deals with data and cares about your data in any way has one. CStar uses one internally. We should have one too. So we're going to make one. That's what the transaction log column family is for. You can choose your row keys a variety of different ways. You could just choose a random set of numbers, some remotely large number, 0 to 100, 0 to 1,000. Or you could say that I'm going to choose my row keys out of the set of all the potential tokens that I have for nodes. Once you have that, once you know what that is and everyone agrees on what that is, then whenever I need to write something or whenever I need to transfer data from account one to account two, I need to randomly pick one of those numbers. If I pick numbers 0 through 100, just randomly choose one out of there. It doesn't matter which one you choose, and that becomes your row key. I then take the time UUID of the account, or sorry, of the transaction that occurred, whatever I think the time is for that. It doesn't require any kind of synchronizations with clocks. It doesn't require two nodes to communicate with each other. It just requires that whatever I want to say this transaction happened at, then that's the timestamp I use for that. I use a time UUID to avoid collisions where I could have two transactions happening at exactly the same time. What that does is it basically guarantees that if I had two transactions happening at the same time, they would result in different column names and therefore be stored separately instead of one overriding the other. The details that I write in there are the same details for the transaction as I had before. Everything about the transaction that I need to know about, the from account, the to account, the amount, the time, any order numbers or anything like that. Whatever makes it unique, whatever information is there. We're going to use that transaction log column family as a transaction log, which basically means it's a durable place to write the changes. When you're doing a transfer, what I've done here is I took data that needs to be updated on account one and on account two, and I put them in a single column. So when I write this to this column family, that's essentially like a commit. Once it's in there, that transaction's going forward. There's no rollback. You can't have that reliably in a distributed system, but I can guarantee you consistency. Once you've written into this column family, that's essentially like a commit. The way that you make sure that that consistency is guaranteed is that every so often you have various nodes looking for values in this column family that are older than 1 minute. The time UUID here is ordered, so you can issue a query to Cassandra that says, for this row or for all of the rows, find me all of the columns that are older than 1 minute, or older than 5 minutes, or older than 10 seconds. When transactions are working correctly and you don't have failures in your system, this query is always empty. It always returns no results. So it's super fast. If I ever do find a result, though, that means I failed somewhere. I don't know where I failed, but I do know that I had intended to write all of the data that is represented in the details here, but that I didn't finish doing it. Because if I had, then I would have deleted it from this column family. So I need to replay that in its entirety. And because the IDs, it was farther back than I thought, because the IDs were idempotent, replaying the value over is not going to cause me any harm. If the value is already there, then I'm going to overwrite it with the same thing. If the value is not there, then I'm going to add it. If someone else has already changed the value to something different, it doesn't matter because I'm going to have an older timestamp than whatever they wrote with. Not to mention, I'm going to have a different ID if it's a different transaction. So if you're writing the same transaction, you just need to make sure that you're using the same IDs, and if you're writing a different transaction, that you're using different IDs for it. So using a transaction log, I can now actually implement an account transfer from one account to another. I can take the whole details of everything I'm going to do, transfer $100 from account one to account two, and in parallel, I can write those to the transaction log column family. And then in parallel, I can write to my from account and my to account whatever their corresponding delta is supposed to be, whether it's, you know, add $10 and subtract $10, either way. Then I delete from the transaction log. And once I'm done with that, I can actually do that after the client response. So the cost of doing this is I've got to do two writes now instead of doing one. But it's a small price to pay for having safe transfers of funds from one account to another. More importantly, writes are actually very fast in Cassandra. There's very little overhead to doing them. So there's not a lot of cost to doing this. So what about failures when I'm in the middle of this? And that's kind of what this whole talk is about, is how do you deal with that? Well, if I'm writing into the column family, if I'm doing these steps, I'm writing into the transaction log, and then I'm writing to the from account and the to account, and then I'm deleting from the transaction log, there's only a handful of places I can fail. I can fail before I've inserted into the transaction log, which is exactly the same as if in Oracle you say start transaction, update account, set account value equal X plus one, and then roll back or fail or crash or get disconnected. So it's like it never happened. If I do it after the insert, if I do it after the insert, then I already have all of my details there. I have an incomplete set of instructions that say I need to go update the to account and I need to update the from account. So whenever that gets picked up and replayed, I'm going to update both accounts and then delete the value, because any node that picks it up is going to replay the message in its entirety from the beginning, because it can't possibly know where I failed. It just knows somewhere between the beginning and the end there was a failure. If I fail after the from account or the to account, but not the other, like I fail after one but not the other is applied, then I'm in this half state until this message gets replayed, where the from account says, you've been credited your $100 that you're transferring from me, but it has not yet been debited from my account. That's how banks operate now, actually. When you write a check, you get, it gets cleared, you know, multiple days later. When you swipe your credit card, it's in a pending state until it actually clears. When you do stock transfers or do an purchase stock on the exchange, it doesn't actually clear until days later. Then the banks exchange big list of things and they figure everything out. That's essentially, this is kind of mimicking that. The important thing is not that I'm temporarily inconsistent there, because that can be dealt with relatively easily. If I'm transferring $100 to you, you really don't care whether it's been debited from me or not. You only care that you got it. And that's exactly what happens here. If I fail after I've done both of those, but before I delete it, nothing bad happens. I just waste a little bit of work. Someone's going to pick up that value, replay the whole thing, overwrite the same data that I already have in here, so I've wasted work, but I'm still going to end up with the correct result, and then I'm going to delete it from the transaction log. If I fail right after I've deleted it from the transaction log, this is exactly the same as in Oracle. I say start transaction, update some value, commit, and I don't get a response from the server. The server got the commit, it's on disk, the transaction happened, but the client never got a response. That's the same thing here, is that I've gone through all my work, and I've persisted it safely to the database incorrectly, and then I crash before I can respond to the client and tell them that I have completed the work. So what about consistency? Well, you have requirements. You should be honest about what they are. If you need a transfer application that will never, under any circumstances, ever allow me to transfer money when I don't have it or complete a transaction when I don't have it, then this is not the solution for you. You need to be on one machine. That's provable that you have to be on one machine or one shared state of resource, one shared resource. Very fundamental results of distributed systems that there is no other alternative to that. I would rather have the availability and the scalability to be able to do this. So you can do good enough type things. You know, you can look at it and say, oh, this is a transaction for $5. I really don't care if you overdraft your account by $5. The risk is so very low to me that I don't care. You could look at it and say, wow, that's a $1 million transfer. I'm just not going to do that until I'm sure that the values are there. You can write the value in there and then check the result. Most people would rather have progress on the accounts that are not down or still be able to conduct business in the face of failures. Partitions between data centers, for example, they happen. If you compare this solution to what you would do with a normal relational system like an Oracle database, you're not going to have multiple data centers in Oracle in the first place. And if you are, you're certainly not writing into both of them. You have to be writing into this data center that has the master on it. And if there's a partition there, then you can't do anything. You're completely down. In this solution in Cassandra, you have the choice. You can say, well, the data centers are down. I can't meet my quorums, so I'm not going to process the transaction. Or you can process the transaction anyway if it's small enough and know that eventually when the partition is healed that it'll sync back up. So you get the choice. Failures for transactions in flight, you know, when compared to something like Oracle, where you can say start transaction, make a bunch of updates, and you commit, you have pretty much exactly the same results here as in Oracle. If I send a commit and I don't get a response, I cannot distinguish between the transaction went through and I just lost the response, or the commit message never got there, so the transaction never happened. That's no different on Oracle than it is here. And in both cases, the same things apply. If the transaction got there, all of it went through. If the transaction did not get there, none of it went through. Which is what I'm going to argue is the important part, is that consistency part and the durability part. The one thing you can't recover from is a lost message. I can't ever tell you that I processed your transaction and then you ask me later and I don't have it. That's the thing you can't recover from. Your bank can always look at it and go, oh, I charged you twice. I'm so sorry about that. And fix it. And that happens on, you know, somewhat of a regular basis, even outside of any of the solutions we've talked about. Upgrades, it's very complicated to do that when you have a single machine, you have a single master processing things. You have maintenance windows, you shut stuff down. You don't do that with Cassandra, you don't do that with this solution. You do your upgrades as you normally would. You shut down some of your nodes, you put new software on it, you bring them back up, you go to the next node. So it's meant to be up, you know, 100% of the time. Don't page your op team at 4 a.m. That's the whole point of this, is that you don't want to be waking everyone up every time there's a failure. With this solution, you can tolerate, you know, pretty much any number of arbitrary failures that you want by having a higher and higher replication factor and actually be up 100% of the time. There's no failover here. There's just go repair the stuff and put it back in the cluster. A few details if you're going to implement this is that for the accounts column family settings, you want normal GC grace seconds, which is a setting in Cassandra for controlling how long tombstones live. I need this on the accounts column family because it would be disastrous if I deleted a piece of data and it reappeared later. I would have the wrong count. I would have the wrong balance. It's row cache friendly for the most part. Probably still don't need to use it. It's key cache friendly, just like just about everything is. So if you use the key cache, you can use it with this as well. Level compaction strategy is probably what I'd run for this, because I'm constantly going to be adding this delta and then immediately overwriting the base and deleting this delta. So I've got a lot of change in my rows. Level compaction strategy will be very aggressive about consolidating those together and getting rid of the redundant information that I don't care about. You should probably use commit log sync equals batch. To make this completely safe, because by default, there's actually 10-second windows where a node that crashes can lose 10 seconds worth of data. So on this, since we're absolutely depending on Quorum acting correctly, then we need to depend on the sync acting, the commit log acting correctly. If you just lose one machine, then this doesn't really apply, but if you lose two machines within, you know, 10 or 20 seconds of each other, it could become an issue. And so this is the way that you guard against that. You make that not an issue. I wish it was per column family, or at least there was a flag that I could say, you know, I've just done this transaction, so as part of this, I want you to sync the commit log. But we don't have that, although could potentially add it. For the transaction log column family, there's no reason that I should hold on to tombstones. If a column comes back to life, if I've deleted it, and then later it shows back up because of some failure scenario, it doesn't harm me in any way whatsoever. I'll waste a very small amount of work, which is easily outweighed by the fact that with GC grace seconds equals zero, then I reclaim my disk space very quickly. I'm gonna write it to disk, I'm gonna write the deletes to disk, and the very first time that I end up reading them, I'm actually gonna reclaim that space right away. It is extremely unfriendly for the row cache, though. You really, really, really don't want to be using the row cache for this. As I said earlier, I generally don't use it for anything, but this has a pattern that's very bad for it because you're always asking for a slice of it. The row cache caches the entire row, so it's going to take the whole row, serialize it, and put it in memory. And when you ask for a slice of it, it has to take that whole row out, explode it, you know, deserialize it, look for the slice you want, return those to you, and then throw away this deserialized copy. So it's a whole lot of overhead that you don't need. You either want to use the level compaction strategy, or if you use the size-tiered compaction strategy, you want to be running with a minimum threshold of 2, which is the smallest you can do. The whole point here is, again, to make it very aggressive. Since I have a GC grace of 0, I'm writing these columns, and I'm immediately turning around and deleting them. I'd like to reclaim that right away. I don't want to keep all the space on disk. I don't want to keep indexes for it in memory. I don't want to scan it with CPUs every time I'm trying to return the results. So this will make the compaction run more often and faster. And when the compaction runs, because GC grace is zero, it's all it's doing is looking at a value and dropping them. It's not actually generating a whole lot of write I.O. So it turns out that the base and deltas don't actually have to represent money. There's a lot of different things they can represent. If you've got a gaming system and you've got inventory and you want characters to trade with one another, then you could actually use this for that. The base would be the entire inventory representation of the character. The deltas would be, you know, who I traded with and what items and what IDs. And I can make those exchanges knowing that I'm not ever going to lose an item or duplicate an item. If I trade an item with someone, I'm either going to keep the item, or in case of failures, I'm either going to keep the item or it's going to go to the next person. It's not going to end up in between. I'm not going to end up with two of them, and I'm not going to lose the item. Stock portfolios, stock exchanges, same thing. Escrow exchanges, if I, you know, say that I need to exchange a deed for some money, then that's either going to happen in its entirety or it's not going to happen at all. Really anything that's combinable, because you control the code that consolidates the things. When you read the row, you see the base. Anything that you can devise an algorithm for to take a bunch of deltas and a base and produce a new base, then you can use this for. Is it the best way? No, of course not. Never said that. depends on your requirements and goals. One thing that is kind of a good mix between this, if you're really nervous about being able to, you know, check for values of transactions not being able to overdraft an account, you can use C*STAR for the transaction log, and you can use Oracle for the balances. So you've got a very durable transaction log. You're not as dependent on Oracle's performance, and you can kind of push these back asynchronously. And you can do the transactions in Oracle so you can see if something is overdrafted. You could use ZooKeeper instead of writing at consistency level, quorum, and all. For the consolidators, you could use those to get a lock, and then you could have many of them, which means that you don't have to do anything if they fail, but then you have to deal with the complexity of ZooKeeper. This solution favors the availability and scalability and durability over other traits. The other traits that I've dropped from this are the ones that you can't achieve unless you're on a single machine. Now, being on a single machine, as we know, has all kinds of problems. You know, that machine is now, your business is now dependent on that. That's as large as you can scale it. It's however big of a machine you can buy. You're not going to be running across multiple data centers, and you're kind of stuck when you have power outages or you have zone failures in EC2 if you're in the cloud or anything else. So instead of taking those strict transactions that we normally have ACID transactions in relational databases, I'd much rather have the availability and the durability. So this kind of gives you the atomic part and the consistent part and the durable part. It doesn't give you the isolation part. That's the part that's different, because under failure scenarios, when I'm doing a transfer, I can read from one account and see the $100 has been transferred, and read from the source account and see that it has not yet been debited. But that's a temporary state. It's guaranteed that eventually that will complete all the way through. Questions? Yes, I think she's got a microphone that she's going to bring to you.
So you mentioned that the alternative use the zookeeper, but then can the zookeeper be deployed in a way that support the locking across multiple data center or multiple availability zone at this time?
You would use zookeeper to obtain a lock, and then you would process the row. You would go read the row. Like any number of consolidators would try to lock a row, and then once they obtain a lock for that, then they can go and consolidate that row and write it back out. Instead of having to use the consistent level quorum and everything, you can use zookeeper for that. But it's far more complex, and under extreme failure scenarios where lots of things are failing, this is actually still a problem. It's still going to miscount your results, the same way that Oracle could.
What was that query you said that you do on the transaction log to make sure that there's no, there's nothing in it? Just getting the first column out is that
so
what the query is?
You can ask for a slice of columns. Time UUIDs are ordered, and so they show up in the row as being ordered, where earlier ones come first and later ones come afterwards. So you can think of them as timestamps, except that they're actually unique. If you had two timestamps at the same time, you'd end up with two columns. You can ask Cassandra for a given row or for a set of rows. You can say, give me all of the columns that are between A and B, or less than A, or greater than A, or any combination of that. Because these are all ordered, and when I write them in there, I'm going to write the time that this transaction happened. And I'm assuming that my transactions are normally going to take, 15 milliseconds or 3 milliseconds or less if I'm all in one data center. But then I'm going to delete this value. So it's never going to be there longer than a few milliseconds. But if I fail, then I never got to this point to where I deleted it. So someone else, basically all the other nodes, would be up and running and say, give me all of the values that are in here that are older than 1 minute. So that kind of places an upper bound on how long you would be out of sync between two values. That makes sense?
Just curious, are any banks actually using this?
No, there's no banks that are actually using this. They have systems that are from the 60s. They wouldn't change it to save their life. That's why they have outages, and that's why they do processing the way they do. They have systems that are far worse than this, where you can be inconsistent for days. That's the normal state of operations in the banks right now. There are hedge funds and trading firms that are using things very similar to this for other things. They're summing up instead of account balances of how much money I have, they're summing up things like averages and volumes and mins and maxes and numbers of trades and open interest and things like that. Things that is very important for them to be accurate, because they actually sell that information, they report that information. But banks, in terms of checking accounts, they have not changed technology in forever. I don't think they're ever going to.
So what would happen if you summed up all the deltas and updated the total, but right before that happened, you did a transaction that failed? When you go to replay that transaction, you're gonna insert that at the timestamp that the transaction happened? Isn't that creating another delta?
Yes, but that's fine if you create another delta. Let me make sure I understand what you're asking. is, so if this was the starting state, I read X and Y and Z. I then calculate that the new value should be X, Y, Z, and I issue those deletes, but at the same time right now, you're saying that a new column in A gets created?
Well, on the tombstone columns, you would replay it and it would like update the tomb, put it back in.
It would not, no, it can't put it back in there because it's going to have the same timestamp that I wrote the original transaction with. And when I do this delete, I know that I'm always ahead of the value that I wrote into the transaction log because I do them in order, right? Maybe I do them in order. Right. So I write the transaction that I want into the log first. That step happens completely beforehand. After that, I now write in parallel to the from and to. When I wrote into this, I put a timestamp in there. That's part of the details that I need because I need to use that timestamp when I replay it.
So when you replay, you just replay with the TTL of that timestamp?
With this timestamp.
Right, and then, but if they're tombstone, wouldn't that get removed and then like?
Those tombstones can't be created until after this timestamp.
Oh,
the tombstone that I wrote is guaranteed to have a bigger timestamp than this. Even if it had the same timestamp, it doesn't matter because deletes take precedence over the values that are there. I think what you're getting at is you have to be careful that you don't use your local clock when replaying a transaction. You must use the clock that was on the transaction. You must save that when you write it, and you must use that clock when you replay it. What'll happen is I have this tombstone now that has some timestamp bigger than what I wrote into the transaction log with, and when I replay this data, it looks at it and says, oh, this one's bigger, my tombstone is bigger, I don't care about that one. So it just drops it. That's.
At what point did the tombstone get erased?
10 days by default, that's what GC gray seconds controls, and that's why on the accounts column family, I can't go more than 10 days. What I'm guaranteeing is that I cannot be down for longer than 10 days, and I cannot, if I'm down longer than 10 days, the recovery procedure is basically pretend the node was down forever, delete the node, add a new node. But if your ops team can't keep things up within 10 days, then you need a new ops team. I'm okay with telling people fix it on Monday. I'm not okay with telling them fix it next month. So, but that's why on the transaction log column family, we set GC grace to zero. I don't want the tombstones. Like they can go away as soon as I write them. And if they somehow accidentally reappear, I don't care because I'm just gonna waste a little bit of work. You optimize for the common case. The common case is my stuff is working. You know, it's the failure conditions that you have to handle, but it's okay if you're doing extra work there when there's a failure because that's not the normal case. Get the microphone, I barely hear you up here, sorry.
So my question is, can we handle transaction isolation levels?
I'm sorry, one more time?
Transaction isolation levels, like Oracle.
Okay, so isolation is a problem. That's the part that you can't get very easily. You can get the atomic part, you can get the consistency part, and you can get the durability part. The true level of isolation requires you to be on a single machine. There's no other way to do that. You can basically say, let's say there's two nodes, they're trying to agree on the state, such that if I read from either one of them, I don't see any previous changes until it's been, I'm sorry, you're asking like, could I not have, could I design a system such that if I do a transfer from account one to account two, when I read, I always see the transfer completed fully, or I don't see it yet?
Correct, that's what I see. It is either yes or no, like either I see fully committed or not committed.
Yeah, you can.
I don't want to see in between.
You can have isolation on there by using something called MVCC, multi-version concurrency control. Basically, what you need to do is when I generate the transaction, in addition to everything else that you have here, you also need to store a transaction ID in another column family that says whether it's complete or not. And the last step right before the transaction log delete is to go change a single column in there that says this transaction is now valid. And then every write that you do anywhere in the system has that transaction ID on it. Whenever I read from an account, I see all these deltas, right? If I'm going to sum them up, I need to ask for each one. I need to go ask, is this transaction complete? If it says no, then I go, oh, it doesn't exist. I'm going to pretend this transaction doesn't exist. And if it says yes, then I'll do whatever it is I'm doing with it. Either I'll count it in my balance that I'm returning to you, or I will sum it up and put it in the base. That's a whole other level on top of this, and it slows things down a lot because now it's three steps on things, but it has all the same properties in terms of availability and durability that I can guarantee that I won't see any part of the transaction at all until the whole thing is done. The one caveat to that is, and there is no way to solve this in any system, if I have two machines, whenever I send out that message that says this transaction is now valid, it could go to one machine earlier and be read before it gets to the other machine. Now, you still kind of have the isolation there, but you don't have, it's not full isolation, because I'll either see all the changes that I made in their entirety, or I will not see any of the changes, but some other reader on some other machine could not see the changes, and I could see the changes. Other questions?
Do you think it would be useful to have or to build a framework that would let you just plug in like your concept of a base value, your concept of a delta, your concept of a transaction, and then be able to reuse this? You know,
that would be very useful. I would have actually liked to have seen counters built this way as opposed to what we did. There's a lot of very complicated recovery procedures for counters right now. I think this would be a better way to doing that. If you have a framework for this, you could plug in your functions of, you know, please add this as an account, please transfer these two things, here's my combiner function, here's my delete function, everything. Yes, it would be possible to build that. I think it would actually be pretty useful to do that. I may do that someday, but if you want to do it earlier, by all means.
Okay. Cool. Follow-up question, what about if there was, do you worry about time skew between the whatever wrote the transaction log and the time that you put in as the transaction log time, and then the combiner that is writing the tombstone? Like there might be skew between those two times, so then maybe a transaction might be replayed over a tombstone. Is that possible?
Yes, but the way you handle that is because the combiner, there's no latency for this. It doesn't matter when it runs. You make that big enough, like 5 minutes. You tell your combiner, don't ever combine anything that I could possibly be anywhere near clock skew on,
okay.
Right? You say, look, I might be off for a minute on clock skew. That's pretty common. I could be off for 5 minutes. So you tell your combiner, don't combine anything unless it's more than 10 minutes old. You can also use vector clocks to detect that if you'd like. That's more complicated, more complexity, but it does give you stronger guarantees over that. Other questions? No? Thank you.